Let's write a function in the lean programming language that computes the decimal digits of a natural number. In the zero case, we return the empty list. And in the n plus 1 case, we take the input mod 10 and constant onto the result of a recursive call. Looks like lean is now insisting that we prove termination of the function. Okay, fine. We write this little proof that n plus 1 divided by 10 is less than n plus 1. Done. Now let's call the function using the reduce command. 0 goes to the empty list, 1 goes to a singleton containing the digit 1, 12 goes to 2, 1, so that's least significant digit first, 123 goes to 3, 2, 1, and 1234 goes to an error. Maximum recursion depth has been reached. How can such a simple function on such small input explode like this? That's the question I'll attempt to answer in this video. This reduce command we've been using is in fact not the only way to run lean code. We can instead invoke decimal digits from a main function and compile that to C code and then to native code. The resulting executable is very fast and it totally avoids the recursion depth errors that we saw earlier. Let's draw a diagram of these compilation stages. The lean tool compiles lean code to C code, and then the lean C tool compiles that C code to a native executable, which we can then run to get the result we expect. The lean tool invocation can be further decomposed into two steps: compilation and code generation, with an intermediate representation, or IR, sitting between them. Now, lean has an IR interpreter that lets us shortcut the compilation process, and we can call it via the eval command from within a lean file. So let's try that. Eval decimal digits 1234 is 4321. Looks good. And it continues to succeed on larger inputs. So where does the reduce command fit on our diagram? We need to decompose compilation to isolate a step called elaboration, which expands the source code into a simplified language specified by the type lean.expr. The reduce command operates on values of this type. This is the same kind of computation as happens during proof checking, when lean needs to compare two expressions for equality. Another name for it is kernel reduction, which is meant to signify that it's part of lean's innermost trusted computing base. Considering that kernel reduction mainly emphasizes simplicity and correctness, maybe we shouldn't be too surprised that it has subpar performance in certain cases. However, the performance is really bad. After increasing the recursion depth, we see that it takes 11 seconds to reduce decimal digits of 1234. And if we double the input, it takes more than 4 times as long to reduce. Compare that to the eval command, which finishes in 40 milliseconds. I was stumped by this behavior when I first saw it, so I tapped my usual lifeline, leanprover.zulipchat.com. The experts there had two main things to say. One, rewriting the function with a gas parameter can help, and two, the root of the problem probably has to do with quote-unquote well-founded recursion. To better understand these comments, let's write a version of the decimal digits function that takes a gas parameter. Now the function accepts two natural numbers, the first of which we refer to as fuel. When the fuel runs out, we return the empty list. And the remaining two cases are the same as they were in the original decimal digits function, but with an extra fuel parameter coming along for the ride. This time, lean does not ask for a proof of termination, because the fuel parameter already has us covered. The function is structurally recursive on the fuel parameter. If it's given fuel m plus 1, then the recursive call gets fuel m. Now we write a wrapper function, decimal digits prime, so that the end user does not need to think about fuel. Will the reduce command succeed on this new function? Yeah. It has no trouble with it, even on 10-digit numbers. And of course, eval has no trouble either. Let's use the print command to peek under the hood. This shows us the elaborated function body of decimal digits with fuel. Whereas the original source code was self-referential, this elaborated expression achieves recursion via nat.brecon, which is a recursor associated with the inductive data type nat. In general, anytime we define a data type, lean automatically generates recursors, providing ways to use values of the type in a structurally recursive way. So what about our first decimal digits function? When we elaborate that one, the resulting expression does not use a nat recursor. Instead, it uses WellFounded.fix, which is somewhat more complicated. Here's a quick rundown. A relation R on a type alpha is well-founded if every element in alpha is accessible with respect to R. An element is accessible if all elements that are downwards from it are accessible. One example of a well-founded relation is the less than relation on natural numbers. Another example is lexicographic ordering on products. Well-founded recursion uses the fixed point combinator well-founded.fix, which delegates to well-founded.fixf, which, via the induction tactic, uses the recursor acc.rec. So behind all the elaboration and auxiliary definitions, well-founded recursion is structural recursion. It's just recursing on this fancy acc type rather than on the type of the source function's parameter. Okay, so apparently fancy recursion sometimes means slow recursion, but what does it actually look like when we run the code? The lean4lean project includes a tidy standalone implementation of kernel reduction. I added some modifications to make it log the current expression at every step. Let's use this to see what's really going on. Here I've loaded up a reduction trace for decimal digits prime of a 9-digit number. The first few steps unfold definitions, yielding the elaborated function body of decimal digits with fuel, which we already saw earlier. As we continue, the expression grows larger, partially because sub-expressions are being duplicated as they get substituted in multiple times. Soon, the expressions no longer fit on a single screen. We don't need to know all the intricate details of these expressions, but the scroll bar on the side here should at least give you an idea of how big they are. Eventually, the first element of the list emerges. The modulus notation unfolds first to hmod, then to mod.mod, and finally to nat.mod, and then we have our first digit. Then the computation continues on the tail of the list. As a sanity check, if we pause the computation, we can pick out some sub-expressions that seem to make sense. So here we are 5 steps deep into the recursion, and we see the input value divided by 10 5 times. When the computation finally finishes, the answer is what we expected. Now let's look at a trace for our first function, decimal digits, with a smaller input of 12. Very early in the computation, we notice a bunch of steps where nothing seems to be happening. A little bit later, there's a stretch of more than 900 such steps. Another thing you might notice is that some parts of these expressions are being printed as underscores, which maybe suggests that information is being hidden. The underscores come from the pp.proofs option for pretty printing, which by default is set to false. Let's try setting it to true. Okay, that's a lot more stuff. Indeed, reduction of these proof terms accounts for what previously had seemed to be vacuous steps. One of the things that compilation does is erase proof terms. Aha! So that's why compilation makes this computation go so much faster. All of the proof reduction goes away. But what exactly is the proof reduction doing? To minimize the amount of syntactic noise we need to sift through, let's write an even simpler function. The function -3 walks back to 0 in steps of size 3, accumulating a list along the way. To maximize the readability of reduction traces, let's rewrite this function to directly use the acc.rec recursor. When we call it with the reduce command, -3 acts as we expect it to. Now let's make some empirical observations about the reduction trace of -3 applied to 10. Although we wrote the function to take steps of size 3, we observe that the proof term in the trace is actually taking steps of size 1, hitting every value from 9 down to 0. Furthermore, during each of those steps, we observe an application of the theorem nat.eq or lt of le. This theorem works by recursively decrementing its arguments until one of them hits 0. Therefore, it's unsurprising that when we normalize an application of it, we end up with a rather large term. In this case, it has 7 nested or.rec applications. If we dig deeper, we notice that all of this proof term stuff traces back to nat.ltwfrel, the proof that less than is a well-founded relation on the natural numbers. Thinking of this proof as a program can be somewhat mind-bending. My understanding is as follows. When a function foo with parameter n makes a well-founded recursive call at value m, that corresponds to this proof taking steps of size 1 from n down to m. At each step, the proof checks for equality via nat.eq or lt of le, which has a cost proportional to m. For functions like decimal digits or -3, the total cost ends up being proportional to n squared. So that's a reasonably satisfying explanation for why decimal digits is so slow. The question remains, what can we do about it? For Mathlib's nat.digits function, the answer is supposed to be that you call a tactic, which carefully sidesteps problematic kernel reductions. However, currently that tactic is out of commission, having been left behind by the lean3 to lean4 port. So we should fix that. It's also possible that new optimizations in elaboration or kernel reduction could make the performance problem less bad. It might even be true that the kind of trace visualization that we've been doing in this video could help in finding such optimizations. In any case, thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.